All right, guys, awesome project to share with you today, and that is this wheel. We're gonna dive into tuning all the different elements of this complex geometry. Now, this is a wheel that is actually part of the Mars Rover slash helicopter drone developed by Caltech. And we've been working directly with Caltech for the last several months to dial in this part in several different materials for all their testing and prototyping. So we're gonna dive in right now and show you our process for tuning the material for this specific geometry on the 22IDEX V3. Okay, so there's several things going on here. As you can tell, I've got an array of parts. I'm gonna pick out a couple specifics, starting with the wheel hub, which is really just a mounting bracket for the motor that the wheel connects to. So as you can see, I've got this part, and this part connects to the bottom side of this part, just like this. Now there's a few things that are going on here. You don't see any holes in here for mounting, and that's because specifically for the holes in here being on a bottom surface, we discovered that in CAD, in the actual step file, we covered up the bottom holes with 0.2 millimeters or 200 microns of material. That way the holes print clean, but the part itself on that bottom layer also has a clean print. And then when you take it off and take the support material away, which we'll dive into in just a minute, then you still have a clean, strong part and you can just punch right through that extra material to use your screws. What did we have to do to tune this part? This is a super simple part. It's very flat, as you can see. It's it's not much material. And the only thing we really had to do on this was actually upping the extrusion multiplier. Now, what you'll notice is this is not a complete part. One of the biggest things that we'll show later in this as well is before you print an entire part, if you're not sure about the exactness of certain areas or how well it's gonna come out, just use the slicer, you can do this in Prusa slicer, and cut a section away from the part. And then that allows you to just print certain geometries, and then you can print that, see how it turns out, make adjustments if needed. So in this case, we actually noticed that the top lines weren't quite fully flush and together. And so as we're going through this, developing our profiles, that was one of the things we changed. We upped the extrusion multiplier to, I believe, 115%, and the final part came out nice and solid, very good. So really basic thing there. Let's go on to the next part. The next part is a little bit more complex because we're actually getting into the geometry of the wheel itself, right? So we have this section, which is just a cutout of this area right here, because what we want to make sure on this part, well, let's talk about it. What are the challenging areas of this part? You've got an overhang down here at the bottom, and then you've got these little sections here where you really want to hit good accurate dimensions because this part is fitting with another part. So you want these to come out as desired at the size and dimension that you want so that their part fits together and you don't have to sand down edges or anything like that before you, after you print your part. So we'll print this part several times. Can anybody guess just precisely what's wrong with this part right here? If you can tell me in the comments below what's wrong with this, you get points. And you could probably call us up and we'll send you a free bottle of nanopolymer adhesive or something like that. But what's going on here? Now, if I look at it, it doesn't look like HTNCF25 is supposed to look like. I'll compare it to the good one. You notice there's some sheen on this part. You can see all the layer lines and they're smooth. This part is matte and it's very rough down here. And obviously it printed like that. So that's an overhang area. And on the inside of the part, even more so, you've got all this stringing and everything like that coming from the start-stop points. Now this is very obviously to us filament that has not been dried adequately. All filament, all plastics will absorb a certain amount of moisture. It's called being hygroscopic. And that means it's just gonna absorb until it's saturated the moisture from the air. Now, in 3D printing, when you're taking that filament plastic and taking it up and down through a hot nozzle and extruding it, then if there's any moisture in that plastic, it's gonna create little steam bubbles, little pockets, little expansion areas. As soon as that water content hits the hot area, it's gonna evaporate into steam, and that's going to cause the entire surface finish to be matte, and it's gonna cause all these other little weird artifacts, and of course, stringing. It's gonna cause that. So the first step here is make sure you're drying your filament correctly. The most basic way to dry your filament on the 22 is to leave it in the chamber with the chamber on overnight. And for most filaments, that will be good enough to get you a good print. Alternatively, you can set the build plate to about 120°C or so, and then put the filament spool on that overnight, and that'll do an even better job at drying it. But if you really wanna do this right, you need to have a vacuum chamber and an actual oven, or even better yet, a vacuum oven. What this'll do is that it lowers the boiling point of the moisture. So the point where the moisture turns into gas is lower. If you pull vacuum with just water in a vacuum chamber, it immediately starts boiling past, I believe, like 15 PSI or something like that. So that's what we're doing. We take our filament and we warm it up. If we're using a separate oven from the vacuum chamber, we always bake our filament, and then when it's still hot, we'll put it in the vacuum chamber and pull vacuum, usually 2 to 3 times, just to be extra careful. Now, if you have a vacuum oven, then you can just put it in there, pull vacuum, let it sit overnight or for a certain amount of hours, and you'll have bone dry filament ready for processing first thing in the morning. Now, the second thing about that is you can't just bake it once, or just take it out of the bag when it's brand new, stick it in the machine and expect it to work. Almost every new spool of filament has some moisture in it. Companies are catching on to this and they're taking more time to dry it and then bag it immediately so that it is fresh and ready to go. Aeon 3D has a whole line of filaments like this. But in general, it might have sat out in the warehouse for a couple hours and absorbed that moisture. And if it's something like Ultim 1010 or a Peak or something like that, it's gonna absorb that moisture very quickly, like a matter of minutes. So you wanna always, always, always bake your filament, dry it, vacuum it, and then have your machine preheated and ready to throw that filament in, and you'll have much higher success rates at beautiful, solid, strong prints. We took the next same section and we tuned it in with nice and dry filament. And as you can see, we're already getting better results. We didn't even let this one finish. So this one actually has the nubs, but we're getting that good surface finish. Now, what else is happening? I think you'll notice right here at the tops, you'll see those kind of look a little melty, right? They just look like it was getting too hot and it just melted and oozed around a little bit. So it was a little too much. Now, that particularly isn't a concern in this case. I'll tell you why. Because on this part, this is a small section of this part. That's it right there. And the time it's gonna have to go around from peak to peak to peak to peak to peak to print all of these little peaks is gonna give enough time for this other peak to cool before it gets back around to it, and it should have good layer adhesion. Now, that is why if you're printing in nylons, polycarbonates, or anything above that, you want to have a very hot heated chamber, because that'll keep your part temperature and the polymer temperature at an elevated temperature enough so that that next layer, by the time it does get all the way around, will actually adhere to the part and have a solid layer weld. That's really important. We want it to look good, but we also want it to be strong. So in this case, these are going to be practically injection molded strength of 3D printed material. But they're looking melted because the printer was going from here to here to here to here to here to here, and the thermal mass of the part itself was maintained so that by the time it laid down the next layer, it just heated the whole part up and looked melty. So we got the overhang dialed in with the good dry filament. So then we came around, we gave a little bit more of the part to the printer to chew on and to print, and it was looking absolutely beautiful. So we got good overhangs, and then the parts up here, well, they're still looking a tiny bit melty on this smaller section. Again, it's gonna have 30 more of those to do, so not a concern looking there. Most of the body dialed in, tuned in. So the next area to think about and tune in for is really going to be this area in here. As you can see, we've got the part that touches the build plate, that's dialed in, that's good, solid. Now, since it's printing like this, there's one section of this part that's gonna have to be on supports so that, again, the wheel hub slash motor mount sits right there. So the motor's gonna be mounted in the middle of this, and then the wheel attaches via screws on the ends. So this whole area has to be on support because it's designed for the wheel hub. And the wheel hub goes right here like that. screws in with 6 screws and the motor stays mounted right there on the body and the arm of the drone. So, tuning this area, we knew we needed to have the holes in these and we had to have it flat and very, very well tuned in. So there's a couple options. We could have gone dual extrusion and used soluble supports that would print flush and make a near perfect surface finish. But the problem with dual extrusion, especially for support material, it's really, really cool. You can do really, really cool stuff with it, but 90% of the time, it's adding a significant amount of complexity to the print. There's more points of failure. You're using 2 different heads. Each head has to cool down before the next one goes, and so you're adding a lot of time, sometimes 2 to 3x the amount of time. So most of the time, we always encourage our customers to design for additive so you eliminate supports or design it in a way that doesn't use supports and still gives you a good surface finish. Sometimes you can't avoid it, but if you can, we recommend that you do. You'll save time, you'll save material, and you'll save labor and failed prints, which is just a win-win-win in a business case like this for a business printer like the 22 IDEX. We had to dial this in and we know we've got the holes in here and whatnot, so dialing it in is gonna be a matter of selecting the right amount of offset from the previous layer. The way supports and laying on top of support material works is that you're printing the part and you're printing the support material at the same time. And then you want to print the actual part. So if you're printing the support, then it's going to continue printing the rest of the part, but it's not going to print on the part for one layer. And then after that layer, it's gonna come back and it's gonna start printing the part on top of the support. So dialing in the distance or the amount of time that is in between when it prints the support and when it prints the actual part is critical. So on this, let me just show you exactly what we went through with V1. So we got a few different renditions of this part. Now, this is the first version where you can see this is the layer that laid down, this is the interface layer, right? It's the layer that laid down on top of this support bracket. And you can see that it's warping up. And that's what we saw when we were testing this also. So we're like, well, that's not sticking. You need your part to stick to the support even with that gap in between. And it's warping up, it's not sticking well enough. Stop the print right then. Boom, we know it's not working. No need to waste more material and time. Let's adjust it. So this is with a 0.2 millimeter Z-gap for the supports, and the fan was at 40%. The interface pattern was also concentric. So we changed a couple things. We went over to V2, which we used a 0.16 millimeter Z-gap for the supports, still had the 40% fan, but we also changed the interface pattern to rectilinear from concentric. So then we went from having a bunch of concentric circles to having more lines and gap fill and things like that on the first layer. Still warping up, still not looking so great. So we had to go a little more extreme and take it down to 0.16 Z gap. So we kept the same Z gap, but we took away the fan. So this third one, we didn't actually reduce the layer gap. Instead, we turned off the fan because the fan is cooling the polymer as it's being laid down, which means it's gonna get cooler faster, meaning it'll have less time to adhere to the part below it. So let's just turn off the fan. It'll have more sticking ability. And then we also slowed down the outer perimeter by 20 millimeters a second. It was at 100, we went down to 80 millimeters a second for that outer perimeter, just to give it a little extra time to stick. But those settings, unfortunately, didn't work perfectly. It actually welded it to the part a little bit better than we wanted, so it was really hard to get off. So we then went over to a Z gap of 0.18. Again, no fan and slower perimeters. And that worked really well. So then you can see the next revision, which of course got broken by Rob or someone, because that's what we do here. We always break the parts we print to make sure we're actually getting strength and whatnot. It's really critical, guys. It's like you can have a beautiful part, you can have a part that's printed in peak and it looks amazing, but if you snap it and it snaps right across the layers, I mean, it'll be great for an electronics enclosure or something chemical resistance, but not so much for mechanical strength, which is a really big consideration, guys, actually. If your part doesn't need mechanical strength because it's a battery holder, like the part we did in our printing Ultim 1010 video, you really don't have to worry about it that much. In that case, it was more about off-gassing and radiation resistance and things like that than the actual strength of the polymer. So always know your outcome and tune for the outcome. If something just needs to look pretty, just make it look pretty. If something just needs to be really strong, don't worry about making it look pretty. Make it as strong as you can. Print that thing with a 0.8 millimeter nozzle. Do whatever you have to get the strongest part you can. And that's again what we allow you to do with the 22 IDEX and the fully open material system, open slicers, all that good stuff. So we got this part dialed in, we broke it, and looking at that break, well, so as you can see from that break, we're not really getting any breaks along the layer lines. It's going straight down, same on that part. That is good layer adhesion. That is solid mechanical strength. We call that good. All right, and that brought us along to the final part right here. Absolutely beautiful, strong, in spec, accurate, and looking good. So that brought us along to the next part to print the entire part at once. And that's when we got this. What's wrong with this? What's going on here? It doesn't look like this one does. And that really is really just because we got something along the lines of a nozzle jam or a heat break jam. After all these tests and everything like that, somehow there ended up being enough carbonized nylon up in the nozzle and heat break or something to the point where it jammed and we had to replace those. So rebuilding your hot end, normal part of any 3D printer experience, especially in these engineering materials, that's what happened here. So be ready. You're probably gonna have to print parts multiple times on any machine. You wouldn't believe the amount of Stratasys prints I've seen that were failed, and that material costs a lot more than the stuff we're using on the 22 IDEX. Now, you might ask, yeah, but they got the certifications. Yes, we have full traceability, COCs and COAs on all the engineering filaments we carry. All you gotta do is give us a call or shoot us an email and we can provide that documentation if you need it. So when it comes down to it, guys, the material costs you're saving and the time just by being able to do quick iterations, or the customizability by being able to tune it the way you want it, whether pretty or strong or both, it's just an absolute game changer. The biggest difference though, is you do need someone with a little bit of experience, or you yourself need to do some research, get some experience, and that is why we're here to help. We don't just sell machines at Vision Miner. We're here to make an impact on the additive manufacturing industry. And that means not just making a cool product and hoping you know how to use it, but we're here to help you as you go. And we're here to help you learn. And that's why we're making videos like this, to show you and demystify what the process is actually like. So we got a nozzle jam. All right, sounds good. Let's pull it out. Let's rebuild the hot end. Let's make everything fresh and clean and beautiful and print the entire part. So here we are with the finished part, dialed in, beautiful, tuned in. We've got our overhangs looking really nice. We've got no stringing, no anything, and the dimensions of these are spot on to be able to fit in with the other parts. So anyway, guys, if you're interested in printing engineering materials like PEEK, PEC, Ultim, CF, Nylon, Polycarbonate, and many more without breaking the bank, but still getting a professional machine like the 22 IDEX right here, give us a call, shoot us an email. That's all we do all day. This is our bread and butter, and we're here to support you and your business on your journey, reshoring manufacturing, rapid prototyping, or just making cool end-use parts for your products. Anyway, that's all I got for you today, so stay tuned, make sure you subscribe. We've got a ton more videos like this on tuning, on materials, on how to do all this stuff coming right up. So hit that like button, let me know what you wanna see next. Thank you so much for watching. Have a positive rest of your day. I'll see you on the next video.